Practically everyone who has seen this musical comes away enchanted. And at preview performances this week, everyone has been a who's who of entertainment, business, and politics. Just last night, for instance, the Duchess of York, whom we all seem to refer to as Fergie, caused quite a stir when she arrived for a benefit performance. There's no question, Phantom of the Opera, which opens officially next week on Broadway, is the entertainment event of the year. But why? And how did a work best known as a film melodrama become a magical Broadway musical? We'll find out, and you'll have a good time, because Bob Brown has traveled to the London stage where the Phantom was reborn.
On this London stage, there are curtains behind curtains, an opera within an opera, faces behind faces. And like the rest of the show, this scene at a masked ball in an opera house is full of drama and romance. And an undercurrent of menace, supplied by a genius with a disfigured face who always hides behind a mask and who could be anywhere within this crowd, the Phantom of the Opera. The director of the show is Hal Prince.
There's a sense of incipient hysteria. Why are they never allowed to be secure? Well, we know why, because before the show starts, there is this opera ghost figure who inhabits this house. And makes just enough trouble when they least expect it.
Next Tuesday, this theatrical spectacle will have its official Broadway opening, following a record advance ticket sale of more than $17 million, creating almost as much desperation at the box office as the Phantom creates within the show. This has been a familiar sight for the last 15 months in London. That's how long the show has been running here. And there has yet to be a performance that wasn't sold out. Tickets for the show are so hard to get that there have been incidents at this theater that resemble the kinds of scrambles you see at rock concerts. And with the critical acclaim that has accompanied the show, Phantom represents the height of the worldwide success of British-produced musicals in this decade. Most of them written by a 39-year-old composer whose quiet country home is about an hour from the long lines around this London theater. This remarkable historic estate is owned by Andrew Lloyd Webber, the composer not only of Phantom, but of Jesus Christ Superstar, Evita, and two other current hits, Cats and Starlight Express. They are all stories told with virtually non-stop music. And his royalties alone amount to an estimated $150,000 a week. What was it in the story of the Phantom that attracted you to begin with?
It is a tragedy, isn't it, really? It is a story of a man who is desperately in love with a girl who he is able to create and speak through with using music, but whose only accident in life is the fact that he was born with this hideous face. And also, I found, I think, the plot that I've been wanting to find for a long time, because I've been bursting to write something with the kind of broad melodic content that the Phantom has for years.
The story that appealed so much to Lloyd Webber came from a 1911 French detective novel set in one of the most complex and fantastic music palaces ever designed. Paris Opera House. It's an ideal location for a mystery with 12 miles of corridors, more than 6,000 stair steps, 334 dressing rooms. The Phantom lives within it, moving unseen in the shadows, but always causing trouble among pompous opera stars and their managers. For Lloyd Webber, that opened the opportunity for inventing operas to go within his musical.
Think of me when we've said goodbye.
I've sort of imagined myself to be a not too good Italian composer of about 1830, because the Paris Opera was very well known for its sort of large, spectacular pieces, all of which were very frightful. And I have a lot of fun with that.
If you ever find a moment, spare a thought for me. Think of me
It's also an introduction to the kind of havoc the unseen phantom has created for audiences over more than 60 years. In 1925, the first of several movie versions of Phantom featured horror star Lon Chaney. He played the shadowy figure who teaches the ingenue Christine to sing from hidden passages behind her dressing room walls, and who then becomes murderously jealous of the nobleman who falls in love with her. To lead her away from her lover, the Phantom takes Christine to his lair in the midst of an underground lake beneath the opera house. The scene that follows required a major change in Lloyd Webber's stage production. In the movie, it's a classic moment of horror.
In the cinema, the audience sees the Phantom unmask close up. And there's no way in a theater that you could possibly get that effect.
Again, it's still too brutal. Really dig in on all that strange, erotic.
In addition, Michael Crawford, the star who plays the stage Phantom, has to be able to sing through a grueling live performance. And because of that, the mask and makeup can't cover his entire face, only half of it. So making the scene work on stage meant giving it emotional impact as opposed to visual shock. Christine is played by Lloyd Webber's wife, soprano Sarah Brightman. When the unmasking occurs, Crawford will continue to block the disfigured side of his face from the view of the audience out front. What the scene will emphasize instead is the anguish in an extraordinary performance by Crawford.
Damn you!
Of a man suddenly stripped of the only thing he can use to appear to be normal.
Is this what you wanted to see? Curse you!
It's total humiliation. It's everything that he's trying to hide and be someone else, to be what he really wants to be what he feels inside, this normal human being, this normal man. But when this normality is taken away from him, he's completely bared.
Fear can turn to love. You'll learn to see, to find the man behind the monster. This repulsive carcass.
She sees his face. We don't, the audience doesn't, but she sees what's behind that mask. Early in the evening, she recoils, wouldn't we all? But then she does something very sensitive.
Oh, Christine.
And that's the moment when I think he falls in love with her.
And she suddenly sees this person underneath this deformity. And she starts to realize, and she gives him back his mask, gives him back his dignity in a way.
I think it's very nice if a whole portion of the audience wished that she'd stayed with the Phantom. But we've got this very splendid, attractive, young leading man who she must finally end up with. It's only reasonable.
An American actor, Steve Barton, plays that third role in this strange triangle as the man Christine loves instead of the Phantom.
Find a way to keep going.
Crawford, by the way, will not unmask himself for publicity shots, only in the theater, where the audience will finally see the grotesque makeup beneath his mask near the end. But all those story elements we've seen wouldn't necessarily add up to a hit if they weren't told through more than 2 hours of Andrew Lloyd Webber's music. according to director Hal Prince, is what ultimately sold the show to him.
Romance. The romantic musical. Been a long time. Andrew and I share an enormous affection for South Pacific, the musical, and for Some Enchanted Evening. And when Andrew first played for me, All I Ask of You, which is the end of the first act, I felt a kind of romantic stirring. I felt surrounded by something theatrical and larger than life and extremely romantic, and I thought, that hasn't happened to me in a long, long time.
Let me be your freedom. Let daylight dry your tears. I'm here with you, beside you, to guard you and to guide you.
Contributed in advance to the success of Phantom. Before the show's opening night in London, a recording of this song had already made the British record charts, which was music to the ears of producer Cameron McIntosh.
There were three top 10 hits out of the show, which I don't think he's ever had before. And of course, the album has sold hundreds of thousands of records, many of which have been bought by people who have yet to see the show because the waiting list is so long.
It's costing $8 million to bring the Phantom to New York, half of that amount for costumes and remodeling to create the spectacular stage illusions.
Slowly, gently, night unfurls its splendor. Grasp it, sense it, tremulous and tender.
The show is virtually guaranteed to run well into the next decade. The hallmark, so far, in Lloyd Webber's phenomenal streak of hits.
What's thrilling at the moment is that the public is now into the form of storytelling through continuous music. They're almost demanding it.
And listen to the music of the night.
Thanks to the music that Lloyd Webber has given him, the Phantom has finally become something he never was before, a true leading man. Unlike the other Phantoms who have come and gone in popular entertainments, there is no end in sight to this one.
Bob, when I saw this production in London, I knew it was going to be blockbuster over here. I did not know the extent of the advance ticket sales. And unless you're one of those holders of one of those tickets, will you ever get a chance to see this thing in the United States?
If you want premium seats, you should plan months and months ahead, because the sale is so huge that the U.S. will have elected a new president before a lot of today's ticket buyers actually see the show that they have tickets for.
Is it possible to take a show like this on the road? When I think of the theater preparation...
That's a good question, because it costs so many millions of dollars just to set it in this theater with the incredible effects, that if they want to take it on the road, they have to find a way to produce it that won't require that expense and that can move quickly in and out of the theaters in smaller towns.
There's a real challenge, but it does have stunning effects. Thank you, Bob.